Well, it's all right. It's all right. Long as I've got my Lord beside me, well, it's all right. Long as I've got his hand to hold, long as he's watching over my soul, long as everything's in his control, well, it's all right.
Moses said, it's all right. When chariots of Pharaoh follow them in their flight, children walk right through, through a wall of water on their left and on their right.
Well, it's all right. It's all right. Long as I've got my Lord beside me, well, it's all right. Long as I've got his hand to hold, long as he's watching over my soul, long as everything's in his control, well, it's all right. Said, it's all right. When Goliath mocked him and he challenged him to a fight, little David said a prayer and then slung a little stone and done him in. And the people said amen and praised the Almighty's might. It's all right. It's all right. Long as I've got Lord beside me, well, it's all right. Long as I've got his hand to hold, long as he's watching over my soul, long as everything's in his control, well, it's all right.
Afternoon. It is truly afternoon as we come and celebrate God's wonder and God's grace. As truly we come and we gather this day, we welcome those who are online as well as those that are in the sanctuary. As truly God continues to give us so many things, including the rain that truly our world needs and this land needs. And so we come and we gather and we get a chance to have. I'm Pastor Craig Larson, I always forget that part, and Pastor Mike Sager. We are proud to be the pastors here and sharing with you the gospel and the good news that God gives to us. And here at Desert Hills, we celebrate,
grace.
We make,
disciples.
Who?
Make.
I've been accused of slipping that in and letting you guys figure it out, so slow that down. Just a couple of announcements as we begin. Next weekend, the fair trade sales will be happening with the chocolates and the oils and the teas. Make sure that it's an opportunity to, in a very concrete way, support our brothers and sisters as they grow and as they produce, so that we can continue to have and that ability to take and have that small farm. So thank you for doing that. On Tuesday, it is the last crash course on church that I'll be doing at 1 o'clock. It's going to be talking about the Lutherans in North America, as well as some church practices. You have not had, like I said before, you do not have to go to the first two in order to get to the third. They're all pretty much individualized. And so we'll be meeting in the fellowship hall at 1 o'clock. Glad to have you here. On Wednesday, we will not be having Pastor Mike's Bible study. Oh, because we'll be setting up for the monsoon concert that night. And if you haven't gotten your tickets yet, they are still available. $25 cash and check, $27 by credit card at the online, or I would say come pick them up at the church office at this point. Then a week from Sunday, if you've ever been involved in a Walk to Emmaus, Curcio, or a Via de Cristo weekend, we're going to have an organizational meeting that's going to be held at noon, or about after the 11 o'clock service next week, just to see about the possibilities of perhaps having that kind of community here. And if you have any questions about that, you can certainly let me know. The Hunger Walk is going to be happening Saturday, September 9th at Quail Creek Veterans Municipal Park at 8 a.m. To register to walk at the park, walk on your own, or just donate, there's registration forms that are on the table. Please pick those up. Of course, we talk about the value of trying to alleviate hunger, and this certainly is one of those events that we're able to participate in. There are still tickets for the Gaslight Theater that's going to be held in the end of January. That's January 28th at 3 p.m. Tickets are $28 cash and check. Just pick those up at the church office. It's going to be a great afternoon as we get a chance to celebrate and see the Pirates and see who wins. Well, that's the announcements for today, and so let's take a moment now and prepare our hearts and our minds in worship this day. Almighty God, we thank you that you have brought us together underneath your roof and those that are viewing online to be reminded of your love, your care, your grace, the forgiveness that we receive. We thank you, Lord, for the promise of sending your Son into the world, regardless of where we are at, what our life has beheld, we know we have been claimed and we have been called by you. God, as we participate in our worship, as we lift up our thanksgiving and our praise, fill our hearts and minds with that sense of joy that comes from believing your promise, O God, that your Spirit is always with us. God, bless this time that we are able to share together. In your most precious name we pray. Amen. We sing our opening song.
What a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning. Safe and secure from all. everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arm.
If you're weary from climbing mountains, and you've been troubled with heavy rain, if you're drinking from a fountain that never quenches your thirsty dream, then come along and walk with me. We'll find the keeper of heaven's keys. When we find him, he'll set us free. Oh, come along and walk with me. For every question and every wonder, there's an answer that satisfies. When your wisdom grows weak from hunger, that's when your soul needs the bread of life. Then come along and walk with me. We'll find the keeper of heaven's keys. When we find him, he'll set us free. Oh, come along and walk with me. All you sisters and all you brothers, if we're the children of Abraham, then let us prove it by telling others about the shepherd who loves his lamb. Then come along and walk with me. We'll find the keeper of heaven's keys. When we find him, he'll set us free. Oh, come along and walk with me.
Let me live, blessed Lord, in the light of thy word. Let my life be a light on a hill, spreading love, peace, and joy, and the light of your grace. Help me spread the good word while I live. Let my life be a light shining out through the night. May I help struggling ones to the fold, spreading cheer everywhere through the sad and the low. Let my life be a light to some soul. Give me wisdom and power every day, every hour. Let me drink from the fountain above. Guide my footsteps aright through the dark, stormy night. Give me peace, give me joy, give me love. Let my life be a light shining out through the night. May I help struggling ones to the fold, spreading cheer everywhere through the sad and the lone. Let my life be a light to some soul. Fire shining out to the world as a guide. Help me rescue someone sinking now with no hope that in heaven we shall ever abide. Let my life be a light shining out through the night. May I help struggling ones to the fold, spreading cheer everywhere through the sad and the lone. Let my life be a soul.
Please join in our litany, spoken responsively. With our fellow disciples, we long to proclaim, I will follow you wherever you go. We come here today filled with worry and stress, leaving little time to consider Christ in our lives. In times of struggle and fear, we look to God for help. Today we celebrate the Holy Spirit, who shows us the joy of following God. Amen.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
First scripture reading is from Jeremiah chapter 17, starting with verse 7. But blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. They will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream. It does not fear when heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought, and never fails to bear fruit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Two, three. I shall not be moved. I shall not be moved, just like a tree planted by the water. I shall not be moved. Jesus is my captain. I shall not be moved. Jesus is my captain. I shall not be moved, just like a tree planted by the water. I shall not be moved. Just like a tree planted by the water, I shall not be moved. I shall not be moved. I shall not be moved. Just like a tree planted by the water, I shall not be moved.
Today's second reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 7, starting with verse 37. On the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as Scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them." By this he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Up to that time, the Spirit had not been given, since Jesus had not yet been glorified. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Beloved of God, whether here in sanctuary or online, may the Holy Spirit fill you with such grace that you shall not be moved, but drink deeply the living waters of God. Amen. Beginning last week and finishing up next week, we're looking at the fruit of the Spirit. What does it mean to have the fruit of the Spirit in our lives, and how is that fruit produced within us? If you were here last week, you would have heard us talk about what we speak, what comes out of our mouths reflects what's in our heart. What we speak reflects what's in our heart. Which reminds us that when we go to plant a tree, we choose good soil. Your heart is the place where God begins God's work in us to produce the fruit God wants for our lives. May our hearts be good soil. This week we are coming to the recognition that just like a tree planted in good soil, it needs to be watered. It needs to be cared for in order for it to grow. This summer, we are reminded seeing cactuses who are designed to withstand severe heat and drought beginning to fall because the heat has been too much and they have not gotten enough water to protect themselves from the struggles and stress of the heat. that just like those cactuses in our own lives, we need to be nourished by life-giving water in order for us to endure those times of stress in our lives. So this evening, we are reminded from the book of Jeremiah that those who trust in the Lord are like the trees planted by streams. They are nourished, and even in times of drought, they receive the nourishment they need and continue to produce green leaves and continue on in life. Throughout Scripture, this idea of living water is part of the images Scripture lifts up to remind us as people of God how to live and how to have our lives nourished. And then today we have from the Gospel of John this proclamation of Jesus about those who are thirst, come to me and I will give you living water. But what's this all about? We see just a small snippet in John where Jesus makes this proclamation. But what does this proclamation mean to the people of God in Jesus' day? And what does it say to us today? In order to fully understand or begin to understand this text, you have to understand the context in which this is proclaimed. Because Jesus is making some very important claims to us this afternoon. If you go back in the beginning of chapter 7, you will discover that Jesus' brothers are with Jesus in Galilee. And they go to Jesus and say, Jesus, we need to go to Jerusalem because the festival of the booths or the feast of the tabernacles are taking place. And you know, as a faithful Jewish man, we are required to be there. Three festivals in the Jewish year, Jewish men were required to go to Jerusalem. The Feast of Pentecost, the Feast of Passover, and the Feast of the Tabernacles. And Jesus' brothers are inviting Jesus to go with them to Jerusalem. And Jesus says, no, I don't want to go. And they go, oh, Jesus, go, because you can show the people how amazing you are. You can do some miracles there that we've heard you've done other places. But the writer John reminds us that Jesus' brothers don't believe in Jesus. They just want him to show off a little bit. They're just kind of egging him on. And Jesus says, no, it's not my time. I can't go yet to Jerusalem. Because Jesus knows, according to Scripture, that the Jewish leaders want to kill him. That's why he's staying in Galilee. Because he knows if he goes into Judea, if he goes to Jerusalem, the Jewish leaders there will arrest him and try him. So his brothers take off. And Jesus stays in Galilee. And we hear from the writer of John that in Jerusalem there's a buzz going on. There's a buzz because they've heard about this Jesus and they're wondering if he'll show up. Even the Jewish leaders are asking, have you seen Jesus? And people begin to talk about him. Some say, well, yeah, I've heard about this Jesus. I heard he's just a liar. I hear he's just kind of wild. And others says, no, he's done amazing things. So there's debate among the people about who this Jesus is. And the Jewish leaders are hoping he'll show up so they can arrest him. But Jesus doesn't show up until midway through the festival. This festival of the Feast of the Tabernacles is an 8-day celebration. It begins on a Sabbath and it ends on a Sabbath. For 8 days they celebrate. This Feast of the Tabernacles was to remind the people of Israel that God will provide for them in their lives. They were to stay in booths. It's like a jamboree, if you've ever done a Boy Scout or Girl Scout jamboree, when everyone gets together in tents and hangs out and does games and celebrations. That's what's happening. They all live in booths, reminding them of what their ancestors did when they moved from captivity in Egypt to the Promised Land. It's a way for them to reenact that event and to remind themselves that God provided for their ancestors and God would provide for them. This Feast of Tabernacles happens on September 15th after the harvest as they are beginning to celebrate all the food that's been provided. And it's an opportunity for them to give thanks to God for abundant harvest. So people are hanging out in booths, and every evening they light these huge towers of flame, 75 feet tall. They light four of them. And the priests have to climb up ladders and light these huge towers of flames to remind the people that God is the light of the world. They say that the towers and the flames are so high that the light from those four towers fills every home in Jerusalem. The whole city is ablaze, reminding the city that God is the light of the world. Sound familiar? They're celebrating the light of the world coming into a dark place. And then every morning, the priest would grab a pitcher from the altar and he would go out to the pool of Shiloh and there he would dip the pitcher into the water. And this was special water. This was life-giving water because this water was fed by a stream. This water was used for purification, for cleansing. And they would fill the pitcher and they'd walk it in and people would be singing and dancing, musicians would be playing, and they would walk through the streets and they would pour out the water, reminding the people that God provided for God's people in the wilderness when they had no water. Every morning for 7 days they make this proclamation, water being poured, lights being lit, sacrifices being made. They say there are more sacrifices made that week of the Feast of the Tabernacle than any other festival in Judaism. It's to show God's abundance, and it's also to remind the people of God that there will be a day that where there will be no more sacrifice, that the Messiah is coming, and they long for it. They wait for it. They proclaim it. It is in this backdrop that Jesus shows up. Flames lit, water poured, sacrifices made, expectations on the Messiah to come. And we're told on the last day of the Feast of the Tabernacle, this last day when no more water sacrifice is made, but just a celebration of God's abundance, Jesus, we are told, stands up. He stands up. Unlike most of the time when teachers sit down and teach, Jesus stands up so all can see and hear and proclaims, I am the living water. I am the living water. All you who thirst, I am that living water. You have just been celebrating it. You have been waiting for the Messiah. You have lit the flames to remind you that God is the light of the world. And here I am. Here I am. The light of the world. Here I am, the last sacrifice to be made. Here I am, living water. Here I am, the Messiah you long for. That's what's going on in today's text. This proclamation of Jesus. And we're told some people believe in Jesus and some people still doubt. But Jesus still makes that proclamation, telling us and telling them, where do you drink? Are you continuing to look for something to satisfy your longing? Or are you going to trust that if you come to me, you will find life-giving water? That which you are now proclaiming, I am here. Water. What are you drinking? I want to show you this picture. So when we used to live in Idaho, every summer we'd go camping and hiking. And this is one of the waterfalls that we hiked up to. It's about 9,000 feet up in the mountains. And what's amazing about this water, it looks really good to drink. It's cold. It's refreshing. But if you've ever gone hiking, you know, even though this water looks delicious and pure, it's full of things that will make you sick. That if you take the risk of drinking this water, you may be in trouble a few hours later. Because that has bacteria and other things that can make you sick. It looks really good. It looks really tempting when you're hot and thirsty. And you go, I just want just a sip. But that sip doesn't satisfy. It just makes you want more. It just dehydrates you even further. That's the problem with so much of the water we have to offer, be offered in our lives. It looks really tempting, doesn't it? It looks like it will satisfy that which we thirst for. If only I have this, then my life would be better. If only I had that, then my life would be complete. We have things we're thirsting for, don't we? But Jesus reminds us that so oftentimes those things that we think will satisfy our thirst only leaves us wanting more. It only leaves us unsatisfied. It cannot and does not quench the thirst we really have. That Jesus offers us living water. Water that meets the very needs that we have in our lives. More than what in our wants, what we really need. Jesus offers that to us freely, in abundance. There's no need to go back. There's no need searching somewhere else. Jesus offers it all to us. The light of the world. Jesus offers us the living water that will satisfy our very spirits. Jesus will give us that hope that we long for and seek in our lives. That's what Jesus is proclaiming to us today. But Jesus wants us to think about what is it that we keep drinking in our lives that oftentimes leaves us wanting more or becoming even more thirsty. I invite you to think about what is it that you are thirsting for? How does that meet your needs? And you'll see that in the dig deeper. What are you thirsting for? And does it satisfy your thirst? Those things that you try to fill up in your lives, does it leave you satisfied or does it simply leave you more empty? Jesus wants you to drink deep the Holy Spirit. Jesus wants you to be like a tree planted by living water so that no matter what the world may bring at you, you will find the hope and the strength to endure droughts or times of abundance. Jesus wants your life to be strong in your confidence of God's love for you. So this week I invite you to think about what do you thirst for? And do those things you bring into your body really give you what you need? Or do you need to trust that Jesus will give you what you need and to drink deeply from that life-giving water? Jesus stood up and said to all those in Jerusalem, "Those of you who are thirsty, come to me. And I will give you life-giving water, and it will flow from your very life into the world." If you are thirsty, come. Come to the living waters and be satisfied. Amen.
Thank you.
thirsty, are you empty? Come and drink these living waters. Tired and broken, peace unspoken, rest beside these living waters. Christ is calling, find refreshing at the cross of living waters. Lay your life down, all the old gone, rise up in these living waters. There's a river that flows with mercy and love, bringing joy to the city of our God. There our hope is secure, do not fear anymore. Praise the Lord of living waters. Spirit moving, mercy washing, healing in these living waters. Lead your children to the shoreline, life is in these living waters. There's a river that flows with mercy and love, bringing joy to the city of our God. There our hope is secure, do not fear anymore. Praise the Lord of living waters. Are you thirsty? Are you empty? Come and drink these living waters. Love, forgiveness, vast and boundless, Christ, He is our living waters. There's a river that flows with mercy and love, bringing joy to the city of our God. There our hope is secure, do not fear anymore. Praise the Lord of living waters. There our
together, let us affirm our faith. We believe that if we live by the Spirit, we should also be guided by the Spirit. We believe that our love should be genuine. We believe that we should resist what is evil while holding fast to what is good, clothing ourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, and patience. We believe that we are to follow Christ, who comes to us from God and reveals God to us. He heals people, transforms lives, and calls us to join in His ministry. We believe that Christ was crucified, died, and was raised again by God. He bids us to rise with Him to bring reconciliation and justice to the world, and to announce the good news of God's love and forgiveness. We believe that we are called to live lives that are filled with the fruit of the Spirit while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We will now have the gathering of offerings.
Night he wandered in to that old mission. The one down on the poor side of town. Really had no interest in salvation, just a place to lay his tired old body down. He said, "Ma'am, I sure am hungry. Sundays. I'm dirty, dead, broke, and so ashamed. I need bread and water. Man, that's all I need. Bread and water. A place to rest my feet. I ain't too proud to get down on my knees, but bread and water's free. She said, you're always welcome at this table. Said, brother, you look like you could use a friend. There's no need to pay if you're not able. 'Cause even Jesus was a homeless man. She opened up the word and started reading about the Savior and the woman at the well. Said, it ain't for me to judge this life you're leading. There's only two things that can save your heavy soul. And it's bread and water. Man, that's all you need. Bread and water. A place to rest your feet. Bread and water's free. He bowed his head, he kind of choked up. And they spoke every word of our Lord's Prayer. He closed his eyes and never woke up. And he'll find bread and water waiting there. Bread and water. Man, that's all you need. Bread and water. Place to rest your feet. Bread and water. Man, that's all you need. Bread and water. Brother, just believe. If you ain't too proud to get down on your knees, for bread and water's free. For bread and water's free.
Psalm 42 expresses our fundamental need for God in our lives. As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, my God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When can I go and meet with God? Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise Him, my Savior and my God. Let us pray. Almighty God, we come this day to give you our thanks, prayers, and gifts of time, talent, and treasure for your mission in the world to bring good news, help, and hope for all people. Lord, in your prayer,
prayers,
We remember those who have recently died, including Mike Hoy, Richard Stuckmeyer, Esther Grimsley, and Kay Sauer. Oh God, receive them into the arms of your mercy and everlasting peace, and may the truth and promise of God's resurrection bring comfort and hope to their families and friends who grieve. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Leaving the prayer list with thanksgiving for healing are Charlie Anderson and Lois Youngren. We take time now to silently pray for those who remain on our prayer list, as well as for others in our hearts and for situations in our lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Gracious God, you are the one who makes streams flow from the rock, who turns the parched earth into springs of water, who sends the rain from heaven and makes the wilderness blossom and flourish. As the deer pants for flowing streams, we thirst for you, O God, life-living God. Pour out your living waters on all who are thirsty. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for those who are spiritually thirsty, who long to know your presence, but don't know where to find you. We pray for those who are alone and without hope, those who long to feel needed and loved, and for those who are searching for meaning and purpose. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for all who are physically thirsty, who long to be healed of the disease that has invaded their bodies. For those who suffer from a lack of food or adequate shelter, we lift up the island of Maui that has been devastated by raging fires and pray for those who have lost their lives, their homes, their hope. Bless those who are rendering aid and offering support to those most deeply affected. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. God, we ask that you would open our hearts to the needs of all who thirst. Give us courage to work together for justice, to stand alongside those who are thirsty, so that all people everywhere may live without want or fear, and may discover the abundant life you promise to each one. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Let us join our voices together as we pray the prayer that Jesus has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We pray that this service has been a blessing to you here in the sanctuary, those that are online. If this is the first time that you've been here at Desert Hills, we invite you to stop at our welcome table that's in the back in the narthex, and so that we can get to know you and you can hear a little bit more about Desert Hills and all the things that are happening in and amongst and around this place that God has blessed in so many ways. And so today, hear this blessing. As you go, go as those who belong to Christ. Love your neighbor. Find joy in simplicity. Make peace with all. Practice patience and kindness in your home. Offer goodness to those who don't deserve it. And let your actions and words be guarded by self-control. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand as together we sing our closing song.
Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go. Anywhere he leads me in this world below. Anywhere without him, dearest joys would fade. Anywhere with Jesus I am not afraid. Anywhere, anywhere, any little fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go. Anywhere with Jesus I am not alone. Other friends may fail me, I am still his own. And his winds may lead me over dreary ways. Anywhere with Jesus is a house of praise. Anywhere, anywhere, any little fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go. Over land and sea, telling souls in darkness of salvation free. Ready as he summons me to go or stay. Anywhere with Jesus when he points the way. Anywhere, anywhere, any little fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go.
Go now, bearing the fruit of the Spirit into all the world. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Anywhere, anywhere, any little fear I cannot know. Anywhere with Jesus I can safely go. I can surely go.